I'd like to invite the principal of Cayfield Campus and Pro Vice Chancellor of the University of the West Indies, Professor Sir Hilary Beckles, to say a few words. Now, Professor Beckles is a distinguished university administrator, a specialist in higher education and development thinking and practice, and of course an internationally renowned historian. Currently Vice President of the International Task Force for the UNESCO Slave Route Project, and a consultant for the UNESCO Cities for Peace Global Program, he's also an advisor to the UN World Culture Report. Professor Beckles has received numerous awards, including Honorary Doctor of Letters from the University of Glasgow, the University of Hull, the Kwame Nkrumah University of Science and Technology in Ghana, in recognition of his exceptional contribution to academic research into transatlantic slavery, popular culture, and sport. He's lectured extensively in Europe, Africa, Asia, and the Americas, and has published more than 10 scholarly books. He's founder and director of the CLR James Center for Cricket Research here at Cave Hill, and he's a former member of the WICB, the West Indies Cricket Board, and is the founder and inaugural chairman of High Performance Cricket Academy of the WICB. So, ladies and gentlemen, Professor Sir Hilary Beckles.
Thank you so much, Master of Ceremonies. Our most distinguished and honorable Prime Minister, distinguished members of Cabinet and Parliament, members of the diplomatic corps, judiciary, church, our students, our colleagues, hearty good evening to everyone. Hosting and toasting our Honorable Prime Minister of Trinidad and Tobago here in Barbados, here at the Cayfield campus, is a pleasure far greater than consuming a delicious dish of Bajan flying fish freshly imported from Tobago. It is indeed an emotional moment to savor. 3 years ago, we were pretty advanced in our negotiations to have our honorable alumna here at the Cayfield campus, but then again, general elections intervene. As I speak, Trinidad and Tobago is deeply engaged in preparations for local elections and by-elections or a by-election, but this time our Prime Minister has found a way to be with us. I am personally pleased to be a part of this proceeding. Our Honorable Prime Minister and I have Our journeys have overlapped in UWI these past 30-odd years. We overlapped for a year at the Mona campus, where we both taught. And again, we overlapped here at Cave Hill when she graduated from the Faculty of Law and I joined the Faculty of What Were Then Arts and General Studies. This history, therefore, makes us shipmates and comrades. What an honor it is, Prime Minister, for me on behalf of the Cayfield family to welcome you home to your alma mater. And to do so during this year of our golden jubilee. I can think of no graduate of our fine campus better suited to represent us at this golden moment. Cayfield today has a 65% female enrollment, and you, Prime Minister, is our most distinguished, accomplished, and transforming alumna of all times. It has been too long since you have traversed this plateau of endless possibilities we call the Kayfield campus. But we have taken great pride in observing your trajectories since you so perfectly satisfied your examiners here at Kayfield. We have observed nothing about your public service to suggest that the word plateau is relevant. Indeed, it is right to say that the mountains you were called upon to climb now pale in the background like diminished distance undulations. We are very proud, Prime Minister, of your achievements. We hope that in the years to come, that you will continue to fly the flag, not only as a Mona graduate, a Kayfield graduate, but one of the finest leaders that this region and this hemisphere would have produced. My task tonight is not to introduce you. I have been deprived of this opportunity, I presume, because I am not a Kayfield graduate. I'm not wishing to be uppity in what I am told is a Kayfield alumni do. I have not pressed my claim. I cannot therefore make reference to my first encounter with your delightful reputation at Mona when we lived in the same neighborhood, when you were recognized as a young black power intellectual with a deep commitment to justice. Now, some of you might not understand the concept, but in those days, all young people who were committed to justice and social transformation were all members of the Black Power movement. My role is simply to extend to you a glorious welcome home to Cave Hill and to wish you great success beginning tonight, but extending to your up and coming campaigns as you craft a brighter day for the underrepresented, for children and the women, and all of those persons who you have championed as persons deserving of greater representation, and of course, in your commitment, Prime Minister, to crafting a political integration in your ethnically diverse nation. Prime Minister, I welcome you home, and may the spirit of the UWI and the spirit of the Kayfield campus continue to guide you and to bless you. Welcome.
Thank you, Professor Beckles. I'd now like to invite Lieutenant Commander Carl Farley, President of the Barbados Chapter of the UWI Alumnus Association, to introduce tonight's featured speaker. Mr. Farley has spent more than 27 years working in the petroleum industry. He's a former science teacher. He's progressed through various positions in three major petroleum organizations, namely Mobil Oil, Shell, and Sol Group. In these organizations, major positions held include planning and production manager for Mobil Oil, health, safety, and environment advisor with Shell Central America and the Caribbean, operations manager Southern Caribbean with Shell Oil Products Latin America, and he's currently group operations manager with Sol Caribbean Limited. He's a trained petroleum chemist, and Mr. Farley holds a BSc honors in business management and an MSc in project management and evaluation from UWI, Cave Hill. Another alumnus, and like Professor Beckles, unfortunately I'm not a UWI graduate either, and I feel a little bit left out here. He's a member of the Barbados Defense Force Reserve and holds the rank of Lieutenant Commander. So, ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Lieutenant Commander Carl Farley.
Senator, the Honorable Maxine McLean, Minister of Foreign Affairs and Foreign Trade, and of course a former president of the Kayfield Alumni here, other members of the Cabinet, members of Parliament, Mr. Paul Altman, Chairman of Campus Council, and Mistress Altman, Professor Sir Hilary Beckles, Pro Vice Chancellor and Principal of the UWI KFL Campus, Professor Andrew Downs, Pro Vice Chancellor, Office of Planning, specially invited guests, UWI staff and students, ladies and gentlemen, good evening. Kamla Persad Bissessar graduated from the Irie High School and went on to further her studies at the University of the West Indies, Norwood Technical College, England, and the Hugh Wooden Law School. Consequently, she was awarded a BA honors, a diploma in education, a BA of laws with honors, and a legal education certificate. In 2006, she obtained an executive master's in business administration, or EMBA, from the Arthur Lockjack Graduate School of Business, Trinidad. On completion of her studies, Mrs. Persad Bissessar entered the teaching profession. Her career history can be described as people-centered. While in England pursuing studies, she worked as a social worker with the Church of England Children's Society of London. She taught at the St. Andrew High School in Kingston, Jamaica, and at the Mona Campus in Jamaica. Later, she taught at the St. Augustine Campus of the University of the West Indies in Trinidad. At the Jamaica College of Insurance, she was also a consultant lecturer. After lecturing for a total of 6 years, Mrs. Persad Bissessar then became a full-time attorney at law. In 1987, Mrs. Persad Bissessar entered the political arena. From 1987 until 1991, Mrs. Persad Bissessar served as an alderman for St. Patrick County Council, St. Patrick County Council. Representing the United National Congress in opposition, she took the oath of allegiance at the sitting of the Senate on November 1, 1994. Since 1995, she has been a Member of Parliament for Separia, serving as Attorney General, Minister of Legal Affairs, and Minister of Education between 1995 and 2001. The United National Congress returned to the opposition benches in 2002, and on April 26, 2006, Mistress Persad Bissessar was appointed leader of the opposition, the first woman to ever hold that position in the Republic of Trinidad and Tobago. Mistress Persad Bissessar was appointed leader of the opposition a second time on February 25, 2010, almost 1 month after she was elected political leader of the United National Congress. On Tuesday, May 26, 2010, 2 days after a victory at the polls, Mistress Persad Bissessar created history yet again, becoming the first woman to hold the office of Prime Minister of the Republic of Trinidad and Tobago. Mistress Persad Bissessar is married to Dr. Gregory Bissessar and has one son. It is my great honor to welcome Mistress Kamla Persad Bissessar to the podium to deliver the 7th Distinguished Alumni Lecture. Ma'am, welcome back to KFL.
Thank you very much. My colleague, the Honorable Distinguished Senator Maxine McLean, Minister of Foreign Affairs, and of course, like me, coming out of the Gayville campus as well, members of Cabinet, members of Parliament, members of the Diplomatic Corps, Mr. Paul Altman, Chairman of the Campus Council, and Mrs. Altman, Professor Sir Hilary Beckles, Pro Vice Chancellor and Principal of UWI Cavill, and of course, Mrs. Beckles, who is also here with us. Professor Andrew Downs, Pro Vice Chancellor, Office of Planning. Lieutenant Commander Carl Fari, President of UWI Alumni. Barbados Chapter, very specially invited guests, UWI staff and students, ladies and gentlemen. Good evening to all of you. I can't hear you. Good evening. After that wonderful welcome from Professor Beckles, I was thinking I should take him back to Trinidad and put him on the platform to campaign with us. A very wonderful introduction. Thank you very much. And Lieutenant Commander, thank you very much. I noticed you did very well in pronouncing my name. Thank you. Professor Beckles is saying, he's having a good time pronouncing that name so many times. But before I start my conversation with you this afternoon or this evening, I just want to share a little experience I had, and I shared many times so that we can see things that have happened in our lives and share it with others. As Minister of Education of Trinidad and Tobago many moons ago, in a previous incarnation, we would go to graduations, you know, to the schools, the high schools, the secondary schools. And so I was invited into a particular high school to give the feature address. And the teachers had decided they will not use a teacher or an adult to introduce me. They would ask one of the students. So they asked a Form 1 student. Form 1 will be, as you know here, 11 plus in age. So a young man trips us up onto the platform. He comes to the podium and he says, "My job here is very simple. All I have to do is introduce Kamla." But, he says, "I am not going to make any long, boring speech. Instead, I will introduce you to the person who will, Kamla Persad Bissessar." That was the best introduction I ever had. Best introduction I ever had. I said, from thenceforth, remember, not a long, boring speech. I trust this evening, as we have this conversation together, that I would be able to share with you in this conversation some experiences coming out of this campus and elsewhere. And let me also greet, through the medium you've set up, as Professor reminded me, that you're streaming live to the other campuses. And therefore, when I speak here today, I speak really, truly as an alumni of all three campuses. I had that distinct privilege and pleasure of being a student at Mona, as Professor pointed out, a student and thereafter a lecturer at the Mona campus. Thereafter, I came to St. Augustine. I was a lecturer at the St. Augustine campus for a while. Thereafter, I came to the Cavill campus. I did lecture here for a short while, but I'll tell you about another experience which stopped me from doing part-time lecturing here whilst I was pursuing law. So also I lectured here and student. And then at the St. Augustine campus where I'd already lectured, I then became a student again. And for a time in my life, my husband used to say to me, "I'm becoming a professional student," because I kept falling one into the other. But you can never lose with education. So thank you all for this very great honor of being here with you as you commemorate this 7th annual Distinguished Alumni Lecture. And it is a great honor again to be among some of the leaders, thinkers who have already addressed you. And from the program, I've seen several distinguished alumni. And this always provides us, I think, with moments of inspiration and motivation. It reminds us of how significant a responsibility destiny has placed upon us as leaders to ensure that our vision, our work, our legacy can prepare men and women of today for the world of tomorrow. And so my theme tonight is preparing the present for the future, preparing the professional for future leadership. I would try, as I say, to have some thoughts, share some thoughts with you on this. But first, congratulations to the Cavill campus of UWI. A golden jubilee celebration is momentous, and so let's give the UWI Cavill a very momentous occasion. It was just last year, in fact, Trinidad and Tobago celebrated our 50th, our Golden Jubilee of Independence, as did Jamaica. But when you do that, as you celebrate these 50 years, it places you at a point in time, at the center of a spectrum of thought, of action, and it allows us equal time to look back as well as to look forward. So, from whence we've come, where we are, and where we want to be, where we must go. In that brief moment, as we reflect back and look at the present, we look to the forward, we say, I can use some words from Shakespeare, William Shakespeare, when he said, "We know what we are, but not what we may be. We know what we are, but not what we may be." And so today, I was a waitress in London as a student, never knowing, when I say today, that was that day in the past, never knowing that today I would be standing here in your distinguished alumni lecture series. So we know what we are, but not what we may be. Famous words from Shakespeare. This campus, in my time, looked different and in some ways felt different from what it is today. As a student, I arrived at a place where the diversity of our Caribbean region helped to unlock the highest reaches of human imagination. I knew where I was, but of tomorrow only knew of where my passion wanted to lead me. The time I spent at this very esteemed institution is synonymous in memory to great change and excitement of a new life. In that single moment of enormous transition here, something else happened to me. My son was born in Barbados, so he's a Barbadian as well. I became mother to a wonderful son, and Honorable Distinguished Minister recalls that she assisted me to get a birth certificate for my son. On a visit, she came to Trinidad and said, "I cannot find this child." Well, he's no longer a child, he's a young man now. I'm not so young anymore, he's a young man in the family. And the minister assisted me. I'm very proud, he's of Barbadian origin. And it shows really how this campus, all the campuses of the University of the West Indies, brings us together as one family of the Caribbean and of the CARICOM. I think that's a tremendous achievement. And if I may leave with you one message, I will leave others, as young students here, especially young men and women, is that we must work in every way that we can to preserve that Caribbean and CARICOM heritage, to keep it together. There are serious challenges from time to time between our nations, but at the end of the day, the warm waters of the Caribbean Sea wash all our shores. Our history, our heritage, diverse, yes, but in the same way, very similar. When I came to Barbados here, I was speaking in the car coming, reminding myself and asking the officer who was in the car with me of things we used to do as students. I don't know what the students do now, but we would go to a place called Baxter's Road. Do you still go, any students? For fish. Oystins, we would go for fish. And would you believe in those days, I don't know about now how many roti shops there are, but we would get roti at Chefette's. I don't know if that still happens. A different roti, but that was like flying fish for Barbados out of Tobago. You would get a Barbadian roti out of Trinidad. Anyway, so I'm saying that great blessings here for me, great experiences. I've shared some of the fun side of it. I was asking the officer, there was a place we would go, it was upstairs, and they would play jazz music. I don't know if it still exists, I'll try to find it. It would be nice to see it once more again. So here I was, and you realize that great blessings, as I said, such as the birth of my son, they do not operate on a timetable, nor do the challenges that come with the simultaneous pursuit of motherhood and education. You didn't plan it, but they both came. And I remember as I paused for a moment, my roommate for a while, she said, "Kamla, why don't you go home with your husband? What are you doing here? You're having this baby. Why don't you just go home?" Well, I remembered something my uncle said to me when I decided, I always wanted to do law and I did other things long before. And I remember my uncle-in-law, when I said, "Look, I'm going to Barbados, and you know, there are some of my friends tell me, Kamla, you're leaving your husband and going, and you know what, suppose he leaves you." And my uncle says, "What if you don't go and he still leaves you?" And that was very instructive, because you have to do what you have to do for what you have to do. And I got a great support of my husband, my family, of course. And so whilst I was here, my family, the comforts of home, far away, but luckily Barbados is close to Trinidad, so we could visit. And yet I found a wonderful new family in the fellow students from all reaches of the Caribbean, each with their own stories, their own challenges and triumphs. And so when I'm having my baby, and I don't mean to be disrespectful, but whenever that moment came, I remember students were living next to me. Shireen was next to me, and she just got a car. She couldn't even lift me because I was so huge. And, you know, got you into the car, took you down to the QEH, to the hospital, and they all came to visit. So that was a new family. And it was that love and care of this new family, the compassion of the administrators here, lecturers here at Cave Hill, that formed part of the foundation upon which I defied some odds and was able to build some of my own successes. So I say thank you, Cave Hill. Thank you, friends here, lecturers and family. Again, give it up for Cave Hill. And so that time here was one of the most memorable in my life, bringing my first lessons in leadership, given a very stark understanding of the need to beat your own path, and a pointed challenge is either you sink or you swim. It is a moment best captured in the words of great writer Henry Ward Beecher, and I quote from him, "Hold yourself responsible for a higher standard than anybody expects of you. Never excuse yourself." And it was a moment in time when there was no Facebook, there was no Twitter, there was no Skype or FaceTime, no emails or text messages. And I pause again. No desktop computer, no laptop computer, no BBM, no BlackBerry, no iPhone. You know what I had? Something called a Commodore 64. I wonder if anybody as old like me could remember that. And the disk was a big floppy disk. And that disk could only hold about two pages of print, text of text. Look at it today now. Look at where we've come from then. And yet we were able to survive. I wrote my thesis, the LLB thesis. I wrote it on that, typed it on that Commodore 64. By the time I was done, I had a pile of disks like this because you had to do two pages on one disk, no built-in memory. So it was a time, I'm saying, where we had none of these things. But yet, the relationships we formed were built on interaction one-on-one because no Facebook. Now, some young people, I won't say all of you, some of you, you live on this thing, you know, Skype, and you don't really meet. You don't even have to meet again. Hi, you have the chats going, everything is going. Nothing is wrong with that. But in those days, our interaction, one-on-one, we shared the strength of shared ideas, of shared passions to become men and women in whose lives, you know, we felt that we wanted to mean something to the world or do something. As Professor said when we were in Jamaica, all of us were Black Power activists, great political scientists, Dr. Monroe, you remember him. You couldn't go to the Mona campus and come out anything except a socialist. You had to. It was a time of your life. And thereafter, I saw so many of my fellow students over there, and even lecturers. Years later, you see them with the jacket and tie and, you know, the Russell locks cut out. But it was a time of formation of ideas and thoughts which have not left us. And it may even explain why. Even as we all ascended to different levels of leadership in our own countries, we have maintained a tradition of warm and cordial relations throughout the Caribbean. Cave Hill, here we met Mona Sandekasin. And this is why the theme of this commemoration is far more significant when we consider the past many of us have shared. We must now consider, I say with the deepest of respect, how we prepare the present for the future. How we prepare the present for the future by relying on our own experiences and those we shared with others here on this campus or on other campuses. And so I say, equally important, we must have a deep appreciation of the exigencies of today's world, where almost every single dynamic has evolved through new thinking in sociology, in economics, in communication, and in development. And I pause, you know, to pay tribute to Professor Sir Hilary Beckles. At the CARICOM Heads meeting held in Port of Spain recently, Excellency, you may well recall, it was a thesis put forward by the distinguished professor on the issue of reparations for slavery in the region. It was on that basis, as CARICOM Heads, we took a decision that we'd pursue, firstly, diplomatic relations in order to look for the grounding for reparations for the people of our region. So I want to congratulate the professor for his book and for bringing that to us. As long standing family members in a region of tremendous history. Time has therefore placed on us a great responsibility to ensure that the people of today are ready for tomorrow. To do that, we must recall, as I say, the experiences in the past, where the future that eventually came was inconceivable. We must also recall those moments, those lamps, along a dimly lit path of progress where our passions were so ignited. And even as we do that, we must also together blend our experiences of yesterday with our vision for tomorrow, to deliver a safer region built upon ethics and respect, driven by passion and innovation, and lived with purpose and confidence. For this reason, I think, it is not enough to simply be guided by the idiom, the youth of today are the leaders of tomorrow. That is not enough. The youth of today are the leaders of tomorrow. It is more appropriate, I say with respect, that we now see the youth of today as leaders already, who must be guided to navigate a world with an entirely different concept of progress. I would like to repeat that. We must see our youth today as leaders already, who must be guided to navigate a world with an entirely different concept of progress. And so it is our duty to ensure that what we leave behind is a strong foundation built on solid ideas, such that when tomorrow's people reflect on our actions today, their thoughts must be woven together by the belief that we did try our very best. My friends, colleagues all, looking back at the time I spent here at Cavell, what I see then, a much smaller campus, one administrative complex, one social science building, and one, and of course, the law faculty building. Professor Beckles, you've come a long way. What I see here today, congratulations again here at Cavell. Congratulations. This building is also, we were just discussing, Professor was sharing with me, this building is also like, you know, a state-of-the-art technological concept, idea that is right here on this campus. My graduation year was 1985 out of Cavell. And I entered the world beyond academia at a time when, if I may remind some of us and share with others, that was a time when the U.S. approved its very first screening tests for HIV/AIDS. The first mobile phone call was made in the United Kingdom, 1985. And Mikhail Gorbachev was elected by the Politburo to replace Shevchenko as Soviet leader. Until recently, this Cavell campus was known as a melting pot for all attorneys trained in the region. And this was not a reputation easily earned. As a student, I had the privilege of meeting and forming early relationships with persons who would one day in the future lead their countries. In particular, I remember the very distinguished late Honorable David Thompson, Prime Minister of Barbados, who was at Cavell in the law faculty at my time. Thereafter, Honorable Frondell Stewart, also distinguished Prime Minister, coming out of this Cavell campus. The Honorable Dr. Kenny Anthony, distinguished Prime Minister of St. Lucia. Can I just share a little experience with Dr. Kenny Anthony? I'll never forget as I pause. When I was at Cavell, Dr. Kenny Anthony was one of our lectures, one of our teachers. And he did a course with us about legal reasoning and research and writing. And I was there struggling. And I was also pregnant at the time, by the way. And I wanted to get an A so badly. And I would strive very hard. And one day he said to me, Kamla, the apples hang on the end of the branch. And you are too heavy to reach the end of the branch. He was a great lecturer, I remember Aston Gibson. I remember Mr. Kamabat, some great lecturers we had here. But for us back then, such experiences with very distinguished persons who have come into the region from my own country. You may well know that the three highest offices in Trinidad and Tobago are now held by distinguished graduates of the Cavell campus. His Excellency President Kamona, the distinguished Honorable Chief office of Trinidad and Tobago, and of course myself in the office of the Prime Minister. And so those relationships we formed back then. So you can imagine when we meet sometimes as prime ministers, we meet, Dr. Kenny Anthony and others, it is as though we were back here in Cave Hill from those relationships we had formed, which helps us, therefore. It is not that we are strangers to each other, but that gives us that community spirit, that CARICOM spirit as family, that we have known each other, worked before, and even if we didn't directly know each other, we know we came from the same moorings, from the same roots, and the same kinds of teaching ideas, mores and values coming out of the campus here. For us back then, such experiences amounted to our version of globalization, where we were brought together by academic pursuits. We were held together by the strength and force of our native cultures and, of course, our combined heritage. And so, if I share with you some lessons from Cave Hill, as students, one of the most memorable points of learning at this campus was that no true or sustainable success could ever be achieved overnight. Remember my story about Miss Dr. Kenny Anthony? Never overnight, Kamla. You have to wait till you get lighter, then you can reach the apple on the end of the branch. You can't do it whilst you're heavy. You have to keep working. In other words, that hard work, commitment, and dedication would always deliver results. Our time at this campus also opened our minds to broader thinking, at times daring us to be bold enough to think differently by leaving behind the rigidity of traditionalism. And so, friends, today, 28 years later, I have the privilege and have been so warmly welcomed by your principal, Dr. Beckles, and by President of the Alumni. I have that privilege to return to a place where my ideas of development, politics, and liberty were transformed. To confess that I would quite likely not be where I am today without the Cave Hill experience here on this campus. And so, my friends, it is not simply under the glowing light of fond memories that I say this. Rather, it is because of the success that Cave Hill has helped not only me to achieve, but so many of us, by teaching us not only to accept prevailing thought, but also to challenge concepts and to be confident enough to defy convention with new approaches that better fit modern development. You know, as someone now trained in the law, I became an achieving professional by combining the evolution of the common law and the legal theories of governance and the underpinnings of equity in the system of justice. But it went far beyond simply lectures on the subject areas. The Cave Hill experience instilled in us and in my mind that even if the application of theories worked in the past, the time will come when we must break the shackles of custom and go off in new directions. And so really, it is one of those very compelling ironies that the one thing that has remained unchanged is the very change that must come with the audacity to lead and be part of the evolution of time and thinking. That, in a sense, is an oxymoron. That one thing that remains unchanged is that change must come always in front of us. This is why today we understand the importance of standing together as a region, even as we guard our separate identities. We appreciate the value of strong institutional structures for a sound education, even as we caution that academic learning is only part of the journey. We appreciate that as individual nations and as a region, it is our distinct character, the personality of the Caribbean person, that has mystified the world for decades. And let me pause to say we have seen our sportsmen from the Caribbean, from the CARICOM, on the world stage, out of Jamaica, out of Grenada, out of all our small islands. We have always done so well on the wider world, in the wider world. So you could give our people a round of applause for that too. So for decades, For decades from our small nations, we've gone out into the world and done so well. Yet we must embrace the need to advance integration, which I mentioned before. We must embrace the need to advance integration, diversification, and inclusive leadership. And so leadership, therefore, is best personified, in my respectful view, by our ability to consolidate what is and to inspire the drive for what can be. I spend a few moments on leadership before I close. In Trinidad and Tobago, the path to leadership has over time placed traditional as well as new responsibilities on my shoulders. As Prime Minister, decision-making must always pass the test of maximum benefit and greater interest, and that has its challenges. Because whilst you look to the greater good, the individual good may at times seem to take center stage and center front. I don't need to give you examples, but recently in Trinidad and Tobago, for example, we put too many examples I will not give, a ban on trawling because we need to preserve the seabed so that we can have more coming out of the seabed. But there are interest groups who are against it, but for the greater good, you have to make sometimes some very hard, tough decisions. We put a ban on the hunting. I mean, they were killing little babies, little baby wild animals, so that you were depleting it. A time would come when they'll become extinct. So we put the ban on the hunting. Of course, there are those special interest groups, don't want the ban. And so sometimes you make the hard decisions. And in these election times, it's like no hunting, no vote. No trolling, no vote. And you have to keep strong. You have to take the decisions for the greater good. I know Honorable Minister is here, will understand. And I think even the faculty here, academic faculty, you will understand it too. Sometimes you have to take some very hard decisions, but you do it for the greater good. It's not ever out of spite, malice, or ill will, but it's for in interest of the greater good. Speaking of leadership, and you will come, students, your time will come when you will have to take some tough decisions. Right now, your tough decision may well have to be, is do I go to the Fed tonight or do I stay home and beat books? That may be your tough decision, but we all have to make them at some point in our lives. And yet, as the nation's first woman head of government, I remain continuously aware that my every action and pursuit in this, we are writing themselves into history. We must inspire each person to believe that the only barrier to his or her rise to leadership is doubt itself. I pause on the issue of leadership again. As I go back, I share, and it's good to share the experiences because there's real life. These words are just, could be just rhetoric, but they come from the experience, the real life experience. In 2007, one day I was supposed to lead my party into an election, a general election, and everything was all over the front pages, and wow, Kamla is going to lead this party. And in 2 days' time, it was goodbye. I mean, she's not going to lead this party again. No, we are going. Two other gentlemen would lead the party. Some of you may remember that. And I went into Mid-Center Mall and I said, okay, I might get licked down, I might fall down, but I'll brush myself off, get up and move on again. In 2007, who ever thought I would be Prime Minister today? Or in 2010, at the time, three short years later. So, do not doubt. You will get some knocks, you'll get some challenges, you'll have some falls. But do not ever, 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 ever give up. Do not ever give up. Do not doubt yourself. You set your mind, your goal, if it's something that you want to do. You may have to divert course for a while, but you keep your focus, you stay focused, like Professor Beckers, who wants to make this campus greater than St. Augustine and Mona. I wish him well. I wish him very well. Given the economic exigencies of the time, I know it's very challenging for all of you here on the campus, but keep focused and you will find a way. You will find a way. Do not doubt. You will find a way. On many occasions, living through what former British Prime Minister, the late Baroness Margaret Thatcher, once defined as the loneliness of leadership, I sought solace in Lao Tzu's timeless wisdom, and I quote from that. When the best leader's work is done, the people say, we did it ourselves. When the best leader's work is done, the people say, we did it ourselves. And one issue that I have pursued with great fervor since becoming Prime Minister in 2010 is the absolute need for a strong system of education, which teaches not only the need for knowledge, but also the honorable and ethical use of knowledge. And I pause again. In my own country, we have been pushing really strongly for education at every level. I had a very great privilege in my first incarnation as Minister of Education to introduce in Trinidad and Tobago free universal secondary education that every child will get a place in a school. And we already had universal primary, so we have universal free universal primary, free universal secondary. In this incarnation that I've been very blessed to have an opportunity to lead, our goal is to ensure that we move tertiary education to 60%. That's at the tertiary level. But also, my vision and my mission is to have free universal preschool education, that every child between 3 and 5 will get free education from the state, universal preschool education. It is challenging, given the economics of the time, finances of the time, but we are working there. You remember the judges used to say, give me the child from 1 to 7, and I will show you the man. So those early years are very vital, and so we are pushing and working toward that. I'm saying education, and you here are into the field of education, academia. And what we want to do is to encourage so many others. Education is the only key out of poverty. Only key out of poverty. Education is the passport to a better quality of life. Look at how many of us are here, Honorable Senator and others who have now received an education. We all came from very, very, very humble beginnings. I spoke a little earlier when I said that I went to London as a student. I had to work to pay my way through school. I worked as a waitress at some time, and then I was lucky to get a job with the Church of England Children's Society, which you spoke of, as a social worker. But that is what has allowed us to become what we are. And so we encourage all that that is the only answer. It is not on the handout or the gimme or give me. It is on education. And those of you in the system now, do not drop out. Stay in. Keep focused. Keep going with respect to education. That is something I came fully to understand as the Minister of Education, I said, during the government of 1995 to 2001. 9 years after on, returned to government, that was one of the first areas I prioritized as a pillar of 21st century growth and development to ensure that the people of today can be comfortably ready for the world of tomorrow. In the 3 years since taking office, this has driven my vision, as I said, for universal early childhood education, primary and secondary, and expansion in the tertiary sector. But we haven't stopped there. As you know, I had made a promise in my conversations during the election in 2010. We would get every child entering the secondary school a laptop. Well, we've been able to do it for the past 3 years. So every Form 1, Form 2, Form 3, Form 4 child now has a laptop given by the government. And by next year, every Form 5. So all 5 years. Again, preparing today for the world of tomorrow. Achieving this vision has meant combining physical expansion of the availability of education with delivering 100% technology and internet access to each child entering school, and increasing access to government support for persons pursuing tertiary level education. We must remember, the attainment of knowledge may be the essential forerunner to achieving power, but it's the appropriate application of knowledge that we can achieve progress. The children of the Caribbean nations are growing in a world where they have to compete harder than we did for relatively less resources than when we accessed the same. I was very happy we were able to partner with St. Lucia, for example, recently, where Trinidad and Tobago purchased with our program, be able to get the discounts with the mass volume to purchase the laptops to assist students in St. Lucia. We partnered with Prime Minister Kenny Anthony, who didn't want to give me an A, by the way, remember. Earlier, I highlighted some world affairs that were occurring at the time of my graduation in 1985. The first approved screening for AIDS, the first mobile phone call, the coming to power of a new Russian leader, the tail end of communism. Today, just short of 3 decades later, the face of the world, as we all know, has changed tremendously. But some of you probably are not even 30 years old yet. But 30 years ago, let me tell you. Today, from 85, first screening for HIV/AIDS, today it is estimated that 33.4 million people in the world live with HIV/AIDS. In March of this year, the UN estimated that of the world's 7 billion people, 6 billion people have access to mobile phones. Can you believe that? When in 1985, the first cell phone call was made. Today, 6 billion of 7 billion. And the 21st century Russia, which was said to be in a period of economic standstill up to 85 under communism, is said to have achieved growth of 3.4% under a more market-oriented economy. What this tells us? It tells us that Caribbean children will have much more expansive concepts of achievement that are built on completely different variables from the decades past. It is these stark contrasts that have partly guided me as Prime Minister, Head of Government, and at the present Chair of CARICOM to deeply consider our every policy and process approach to sustainable development. Diversity as we knew it in our time as students has evolved to such an extent that it has taken on a life virtually on its own. Beyond heritage, beyond culture and ethnicity, we are now at a moment in time where education and social systems must be broad enough to identify the very natural learned skills and abilities of children. The full development of our children that will guide their successful leadership tomorrow must be steered by wider training of teachers to be able to identify social, mental, or emotional disorders which may hamper learning. Nowadays, they were not doing that in our regions. It is something we must pay special attention to. And if I may pause again, at the moment, the CARICOM, through the urgence of Haiti, is pushing very heavily for special programs from the United Nations with respect to children with disabilities and persons with disabilities and challenges. So that is a pathway we will be pursuing as well from the CARICOM agenda. But we must pay more attention to that within our own individual nation states. A modern system of education must also be able to identify particular strengths in sport as well as the arts. And I see here these lovely buildings, the Derek Walcott you told me, and you have the Nettleford on the other side, in the arts as well, to go further by providing appropriate frameworks that will encourage students to pursue their talents, to reward them by stimulating economies to create opportunities. In Trinidad and Tobago, we have pushed the boundaries further out by reforming the system of early childhood education, an education subsector where we are under a target of 100% access, getting there. At this level, the education system has been navigated in a new direction to focus on the very exciting aspect of learning, drawing out the natural and potential talents of children, and advancing methods of identifying factors and causes of slow learning, indiscipline, and underachievement. The secondary school system has taken a quantum leap forward by every student receiving the web-enabled laptop. This has virtually eliminated the digital divide between them and their counterparts around the world. And listen, you know when we gave that laptop to that 4-month child and 2 and 3, you know? When that child takes that laptop home, everybody in the house now has access to the laptop. So it has opened up a whole new digital world. It is a program I recommend, and you young ones, when you go back to your own countries and here in Barbados, it is a program I strongly, strongly recommend be implemented. A mother told me recently, she said, you know, Prime Minister, I was at home and my daughter was there on her internet, on the computer, and I'm busy trying to find a recipe to make some kind of dish. I can't remember what it was. And the daughter said, this 11-year-old said, don't worry, Mama, I'll just Google it. The world at your fingertips. And then when the child has it, every other member of that family has access to the World Wide Web and the world of knowledge. So even more important or equally important than technology access by students to the school has now opened a long shut window of opportunity in the context of understanding the world around us and around them, exposing them to life-changing events and emerging social issues, giving them access to new learning methods, expanding the understanding of the value and impact of a sound education and its application in the real world, opening countless research sources for academic and social advancement, and deepening their insight into world affairs that will form the future they will one day inherit. My grandson, born here in Barbados, is now 8 or whatever. When he was... Not my grandson, my son. He's the son of the Barbadian son. Some young ones with him, his friends, and he's there. And somebody said, talk about a zombie. He said, Grandma, what is a zombie? He said, look, don't worry, I'll just Google it. And he was between 6 and 7. It's amazing. And they are so in tune. I know some of us, older generation, so resistant to change, we will not even touch a computer. I cannot imagine what the world was like, even I was there, without the computer. I just cannot imagine how difficult life was, how little knowledge we had, and yet we've done so well. So it is my firm belief that for our children to ably compete in tomorrow's world, their right of access to technology must be seen as being equal to their right of access to education itself. So first, our aim was to give them access to education. Now is what type of education? And I'm saying it has to be, that education must involve a right of access to technology. To achieve that reality, our region's political thinking, approach to economic planning, and relationships with other countries through well-woven diplomatic and trade relations must continue to advance. Our approach to governance must be guided by a form of business thinking, by seeing progress as a profit we earn from our investments in time and education. This is what tomorrow's world will demand. And it will demand of today's young people. That is what tomorrow's world will demand. It is our duty to ensure that they are ready. Just a few more words before I close. Achieving that great tomorrow must begin by sowing the seeds of achievement today. As individual governments and as a region of nations brought together by our desire for excellence, we can work together to accomplish this goal. It must begin by not telling children and young people of a region what or how to think. It must begin, rather, by providing them with a stable platform upon which they can think and innovate for themselves. For this to happen, we must cultivate a culture of not simply equality, but the words used by my esteemed colleague, we must also cultivate a culture of social justice. Social justice. Whence we began, there shall we continue to go. One of the most important factors in achieving the kind of progress we want is the guarantee of strong democratic processes that assure the protection of rights and freedoms. This principle is shared by the Secretary General of the United Nations, Ban Ki-moon, who is on record as saying, and I quote, "As we know, infrastructure is not just a matter of roads, schools, and power grids. It is equally a question of strengthening democratic governance and the rule of law. Without accountability, not only of the government to its people, but of the people to each other, there is no hope for a viable democratic state. It is therefore imperative that the foundation of our policies to advance our objectives for sustainable development, we must make sure that we, our policies, can achieve that. Progress, peace, these must be held together. These must be held together by the guarantee, rule of law, social justice, accountability, and transparency. And as long as we measure our progress, we can see the stability of democracy, we can see the creation of opportunities and the achievement of our children, we will overcome the challenges that we face. And while we face the world as relatively small island nations, we are driven by big passions, strong innovations, and the ability to assume our place on the world stage with a commanding presence. Colleagues, esteemed ministers, members of parliament, esteemed distinguished principal, members of the faculty here, staff, students, as I conclude, I urge all members of the Caribbean family never to succumb to short-term benefit over larger responsibility for long-term sustainability. Today's world was built because our leaders of yesterday appreciated how much we relied on them to pursue the right objectives and achieve outcomes that would work in our favor. It is now for us to ensure that the inheritance passed on to tomorrow's people is stronger. It is more inclusive. And yes, It is without doubt that we will want to ensure that the legacy we leave behind is one built on integrity and honor. But if we are committed to the well-being of tomorrow's people and dedicate our energies to what we must do, a proud legacy will build itself. I say from the old proverb, the old saying, we do not own this earth. We do not own this piece of earth, this land today. We inherited from our forefathers. We hold it in trust for the children of tomorrow. And therefore, we must do the right thing because it is the right thing to do. I congratulate you once again on your 50th anniversary and extend the hope that as we all move forward together, we do so as people united in purpose and in vision and in mission, and as a region that is unafraid to stand and shine wherever tomorrow's people take us. I thank you all very much. May God continue to bless each and every one of you. May God continue to bless this Cave Hill campus. Indeed, may God continue to bless the entire UWI and that of the CARICOM region. I thank you all again, and God bless you.
Madam Prime Minister, I know I'm not the only person here who probably for the first time, or certainly in my experience, wished that the lecture had gone on longer. And I speak as a lecturer, of course. I'm sure many students here will agree with that. That was warm and witty and perceptive and profound. Very, very, very good. Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, the Prime Minister will accept a few questions. If anyone has some questions they would like to ask, let me just add, though, that please make sure that the questions, if you have one, are restricted to the topic that the Prime Minister has just addressed.
Hello, good night. Good night, Madam President. Good evening to all of you. My name is Sunshine. I'm a student here at the University of the West Indies, and I also graduated from the Hewitting Law School on Saturday past. On that occasion, we were addressed by President Carmona. As you mentioned, he is also a graduate of this campus and of the Hewitting Law School. And he impressed upon us the importance of the CCJ. And so with regards to your comments, where you said the infrastructure is a question of strengthening democratic government and the rule of law, my question is, why does the Trinidad and Tobago government lack confidence in the Caribbean Court of Justice to be the final civil court of appeal?
That is a very politically charged issue.
Thank you.
But you are entitled to seek an answer as a lawyer yourself. Trinidad and Tobago had committed to the CCJ at one point in time and had indicated that they would sign into the CCJ based on consultations and activity. That was under the first UNC incarnation in government. Thereafter, attempts by the former administration to introduce it did not secure the requisite majority in the parliament, because once again, the opposition then did not support that particular move to the CCJ. There are many in the region, in the country, who believe we should go CCJ route. There are others who do not. As I say, it's a political issue. It is not one that we felt as politicians we must take on our own. Recently, I tried to do a partial accession to the CCJ. I went to the CARICOM heads and I requested to allow us to do it on a phased basis. That was rejected, so we'll continue to try. The time will come. When the time is right, it will happen. But as I say, it's a very political issue for Trinidad and Tobago at this time. Yes.
We are post-independent countries of the region, and we are attempting, all of us, from Trinidad and Tobago right through, to reserve jobs and positions in our society for our nationals. Trinidad and Tobago has apparently led the region in preserving positions within Trinidad and Tobago for its people. What is your future policy? Because what I'm saying is there are some countries Let me come to the point. My country, Barbados, is one in which every year about 30 or 40 people from outside the region, not looking like you or I, come into this country under something called work permit, having found no one suitable. It is our intention to apply to the Chief Immigration Officer for our permission to advertise for a non-national to fill the post up, and that usually is a Caucasian non-national. How far has Trinidad gone in preserving positions in our society, in your society, in key areas like tourism, engineering, agriculture, etc., for your nationals? Realizing, of course, that this is a globalized world, and you are supposed to allow persons to apply for positions in your country. Because I asked the question, because I think that our countries need to be guided by the experience of Trinidad, which has been foremost in protecting jobs for its people.
I think your Minister of Foreign Affairs may have to answer the policy direction. But, you know, we in the CARICOM, we work very hard, not just to preserve jobs for our nationals, but for CARICOM. We have passed legislation. I remember in my first incarnation as a legislator, we passed legislation for skilled personnel coming out of any other CARICOM region to have free access into any other region. So we've created that opportunity. We also have within the Treaty of Chagaramas, the revised Treaty of Chagaramas, where a national out of any one of the CARICOM nations can enter for 6 months without a visa. That position was upheld by the recent Caribbean Court of Justice decision, if you recall. Sorry, Barbados, but the decision upheld the thinking behind the treaty, which was as a CARICOM national, you can come in, you don't need a visa for at least 6 months. But if you're a skilled CARICOM national, then you are also entitled on the legislation we passed. In terms of other people coming in, we recently had the experience where a Canadian national was appointed at one of the highest offices as our commissioner of police. I don't know if you recall that. And the deputy commissioner of police was also a foreigner. So there is, whilst we seek to put into place mechanisms to first give our nationals the opportunity, there may be areas where we need persons to come from outside of Trinidad and Tobago, and even outside of CARICOM. Right now, we have a serious shortage of specialized doctors and nurses. So we've advertised, Grenada said they would help us with some nurses, but we still have a very serious shortage. And where those shortages exist, we would have to source personnel from outside of the country, outside of the region, and internationally. And so the policy would be, I would think, once we can find persons within the country and or within the region, that we would want to use that those personnel first before we source persons from outside of the region completely. I don't know if that helps you with the policy that we are working with. Okay, thank you.
Perhaps one more question.
In your presentation, you spoke to social progress as it relates to catering for children who are disabled. What are your views on catering to the rights of LGBT persons, that's lesbians, gays, bisexuals, and transgender, within the Caribbean context?
That is also a politically charged question, I must say. We have been for decades, well, for at least one decade, trying to develop a gender policy which takes into the issues that you've raised. We cannot get any consensus, and as a politician, I listen and then lead. And therefore, we must have consensus on issues. It cannot be my individual thinking. That policy was put out. We had tremendous protest from various sectors of the community. So that too, as I say, is one that you must have the consensus of the population before you can go forward with it. I'm a pragmatic politician in that sense. I do not want to impose my views, but we seek to get the consensus of views of the greater good, the majority of the population. The gazumped lady gets a chance, or?
I think so.
Oh, let's give her a chance. Yeah, that's okay. Just one more.
Quick, please.
Mm-hmm. Hi, good night. My name is Amelin Mendes. I'm from Belize. I will be graduating from the Cave Hill campus next week with my master's in international trade policy. I want to applaud the policy that Trinidad has taken with the access to computers. I wanted to know if you would be able to push that at CARICOM and maybe present it to COTED to get it mandated so to speak, to the rest of the CARICOM states, because I think it's very essential. I just did my thesis on small states and the knowledge economy, and it focused on human capital development and education. So I would just like your input on this. Is it a possible reality?
We would certainly advocate the position, but I do understand it will be, it's also an economic issue, you know, in terms of the finances. Right now, our nation states are really in economic difficulty, and therefore priorities may be slightly different, but there may be ways for partner. I know, as I said, we partnered with St. Lucia, for example, to assist St. Lucia. I know St. Kitts has a program as well, and certainly Belize, St. Kitts has a computer program going for the children, and certainly Belize, I'm sure there may be something that could be discussed for partnering. You know, and that's where we come back in. We're small little nation states. We have one vote, yes, at the UN. We have, so one vote, one nation. But if we band together as 14 CARICOM nations, we are stronger. We have 14 votes. But also, if we have to buy products and we do it in bulk, instead of buying for my 20,000 students at home, if we buy for 40,000 students or 60,000 students in the region, we can be buying at a much, much, much discounted price. So that's one way we can partner together, you know, for something so fundamental. So when you go back to Belize, you do your international relations, we are willing to talk with you. Out of Belize, I mean. You can make, and we can make representation at the CARICOM. But again, each state, each nation will have to put their priorities. Healthcare may be the first priority. If you see, because if you're not alive, you can't use a laptop. So healthcare may be more a priority given your scarce resources. Thank you all very much and good night.
Thank you again, Prime Minister. Ladies and gentlemen, UISTAT, which stands for the UWI Students Today, Alumni Tomorrow, was developed in 2005 by the Vice Chancellor, Professor E. Nigel Harris, in association with the Director of Alumni Relations in the Vice Chancellor's office and the Guild of Students of the three UWI campuses, to increase regional ties between students and alumni and to create student awareness of alumni relations and alumni involvement. I now invite the current president of UISTAT, Mr. Chris Liebert, to give the vote of thanks.
Ladies and gentlemen, I bid you a pleasant evening. Mr. Chairman, with your permission, I wish to adopt the protocol that has been established. It gives me great pleasure to move the vote of thanks on this auspicious occasion in my capacity as president of UISTAT, the Vice Chancellor's Ambassador's Corps. The evening's proceedings has been punctuated with the contributions of several individuals, groups, and entities to which sincere gratitude must be extended. First and foremost, we give thanks to the Almighty God for providing us with the various skills and mercies that ensured the success of this event. We are indeed grateful for the work of Mr. Robert Leeshan, our chairperson, who did a remarkable job in ensuring a smooth flow of the night's activities. To our principal and pro-vice chancellor, Professor Sir Hilary Beckles, we say a hearty thank you for your words of welcome and encouragement. It is always a joy to have you in our midst. Thanks must also be expressed to Lieutenant Commander Carl Farley, President of the Barbados Chapter of the University of the West Indies Alumni Association, who so ably presented a brief biography of our featured speaker. I now turn to the Lady of the Hour, the Honorable Kamla Persad Bissessar, Prime Minister of the Republic of Trinidad and Tobago. It is always a delight to welcome home our distinguished alumni. As one of the sitting prime ministers that the Cavill campus has produced, you make us all feel proud to be associated with this homegrown institution and the traditions of excellence that are synonymous with it. We are indeed grateful for your invaluable contribution to Reunion Week 2013, having agreed to deliver the 7th Distinguished Alumni Lecture. The topic, the present, preparing the present for the future, preparing the professional for future leadership, was indeed a fitting one. In a nutshell, you encouraged us to nurture the minds of our young people with the aim of inspiring them to play an active role in the development of this region, of this regional space that we call our home, through integration, wise decision-making, and sound leadership. We must dispel all elements of doubt and stay focused on our goals and the overall vision we have for our people. As Proverbs 29 and verse 18 states in part, and I quote, "Where there is no vision, the people perish," unquote. Once again, we say thank you. To the specially invited guests and other members of the audience, thank you very much for gracing us with your presence. Special mention must also be made of the hardworking executive and members of the Barbados chapter of the University of the West Indies Alumni Association, the staff of the Office of Students, Corporate and Alumni Relations, the UWISTAT Vice Chancellor's Ambassadors Corps, the management and staff of the Errol Barrow Center of Creative Imagination, EBCCI, the ushers, security team, and our skilled caterers, as well as the press. Your hard work and commitment is highly commendable, and for this, we say a hearty thank you.
I now call on Mrs. Rosanna Maxwell, the Alumni Coordinator in the Office of Student Corporate and Alumni Relations here at KFIL, to make a presentation to the Prime Minister. Does conclude our proceedings for this evening. Oh, okay. That's nice. So all that's left for me to do now is to thank Prime Minister Persad Bissessar once again for a really fantastic talk. I think we can all agree on that. It's really exceptionally interesting and moving too, and perceptive and profound. And I want to thank you all for coming, and to those of you who are watching on live stream as well, thank you for streaming. Thank you very much and good night.